at the Land Academy. Thanks for the opportunity to share some very special work and experiences with you tonight. Also thanks to Laurel, who I believe I had a Laurel sighting. There she is. And my influences, as well as Margaret Dyer. I can just keep going down the list. So it's fantastic to be among such wonderful friends in art. And, you know, life at times can be difficult, and even at times in today's day and age can feel like, you know, we're overwhelmed by the cloud of darkness or the veil of any type of oppression or confusion or despair. And tonight I really want to take you on a journey, really through that passage, through some painful experiences, some broken things, and bring us to a place of hope. I really believe art is powerful. I think it's powerful to tell stories. I think it's very powerful to lift the human spirit. It's a powerful means by which we can help people reflect on their own story, their own journey. And somehow in the mystery of that dialogue between the viewer and the artist, the viewer is invited to live a better story and to consider ways that they can engage their world with hope. So that's what we're going to do tonight. This all began about 12 years ago for me, and it happened when I visited Rwanda. And the way that happened was, I'm a member of a church in Bethel, Connecticut called Walnut Hill Community Church, and they were sending out a team. They had just partnered with a group called World Relief in the Great Lakes region of Africa, Rwanda, Burundi, and Congo. And we kind of knew nothing about it, so it was an initial vision trip. And so in January of 2005, I found myself with two other folks being kind of knighted as the resident, you know, artist, observer, photographer of this trip. And I found myself here in this extraordinary place. Rwanda's, I think it's about the size of Maryland. It's a small place in the center of Africa. And I just was riveted by everything I saw, by what I encountered there. And when I returned, I began instantly to create this series of work. I never really intended that this would be a collection of paintings. I was just compelled, right? I mean, what I had seen had changed my life. It was as if before that I, you know, painted pictures, and after that I was on this compulsory journey of being able to reflect the beauty I was seeing in these oftentimes painful and broken places. So in 94, as many of you know, there was a genocide in the country of Rwanda. The president of the country's plane was shot down. He was a Hutu. There are two primary tribes in Rwanda, the Hutu and the Tutsi. And while no one knew at the time who shot that plane down, Hutu militia, about 200,000 of them, mobilized a very efficient grassroots genocide. Neighbor killed neighbor. Friend killed friend. The intention was to kill every Tutsi who had been really the privileged tribe. So this was a war of tribalism. And even moderate Hutus were killed in this genocide, who, you know, were trying to build bridges between the two tribes. And this was a photograph I took on a visit to a memorial site where they had open mass graves, bodies covered with lime. You could still see the wounds. You could see the impact of the machete used to gruesomely murder one another. And one of the difficult things for me as a Christian man was that in this genocide, Christian killed Christian. So it was a very bewildering time. It's a beautiful country. This is one of my landscapes from the series called Heaven on Earth. They call Rwanda the land of 1,000 hills because, in fact, there really are hills upon hills upon hills. And it's primarily a subsistence farming culture. So all these little patches you'll see on the hillside are little plots of land. While the genocide ended, the scars remain. But Rwanda has moved quite a distance from where they were in 94. There were village-led councils. They were called Gacaca, I believe. I'm probably butchering the pronunciation, but they were actually, there were so many people involved that when they wanted to bring justice for the crimes that were done, they did it at the local level in villages, doing these Gacaca courts. So one of the things that I think Rwanda did admirably was they actually had a pathway for justice. They dealt with the horrific things that happened in their own borders. When I got back from Rwanda, this was the very first painting I created, and I couldn't get to my easel fast enough. I met this little one in the city of Kigali, which is the main city in Rwanda, and she was stunning, and I couldn't tell you her name, but she wandered up with this tattered dress and this empty little cup with a spoon in it, and for me, she just struck me as this poignant sort of symbol of this disparity, this difficult thing, the beauty of this child, the brokenness of this place. You know, poverty is still a great issue in Rwanda. HIV/AIDS spread rapidly during the genocide because rape was an act of war. And so they would have HIV-positive individuals rape women en masse to spread that disease. As a subsistence farming culture as well, the parents are out working in the tea plantation or the coffee pot or growing the tomatoes or whatever it is. And they're not always able to care for the kids. But this for me was, it was an out-of-body experience to paint it. I remember it so well. And everyone who began to look at the work I did at that time 12 years ago said, there's something entirely different about this. It was resonating on a different level. I was gonna say before, I'll have like 10 minutes of Q&A at the end. I'm the kind of person who would pepper it through, but we'd probably be here for 3 hours, wouldn't we, Todd? This painting's in the show, and it's a painting I call No More Tears, and I met this little girl. Everyone in these paintings I met personally in one encounter or another. She happened to be sitting on the lap of her mother, who was in the hut of her grandmother. This was 2005, so her grandmother was an HIV/AIDS carrier. And here she was, and she was just fussing like a little one in there as we talked to the family. And just for me, it's like, it's a portrait that just pleads the case for children. Children who ought to be loved, ought to have safety, ought to be provided for, right? I mean, you would, no matter what, that's what I want for my two sons, that's what any of us wants for our kids. And it was such a powerful experience to want that for this child as well, certainly in light of the legacy that she lived in, her family line, surviving genocide and also dealing with the impact of HIV/AIDS. This painting's in the show as well. I was talking to a friend this evening that I would love to add some sparkle to that background. I love this little boy's chest and the velvety, feeling on his chest. But I painted this quite a while ago and would love to add some fun sparkle to it. But this little guy, he was walking in his underwear. Just a beautiful boy, and you'll just see kids everywhere in Rwanda walking around. It's kind of, you know that phrase, it takes a village to raise a child. Well, the village raises the kids in Rwanda. I mean, it's just how it works, you know. You don't know whose parents a child is, and everyone's kind of disciplining the kids or loving the kids or moving the kids along. But I call this painting Looking Up. Much of the engagements I had with the kids, the families, the people there, I had through World Relief's development work, and they made a commitment after the genocide to be there for the long haul. They're still there, as are many other relief and development organizations, helping to care for HIV/AIDS, which has been brought down substantially, doing microfinance with mostly women. But, you know, kids like this guy die for needless reasons. Just malnutrition. Stunting affects something like almost 50% of the kids in Rwanda because they're just not getting the everyday nutrients in their diet because they're not being, it's not being overseen. In many cases, there's ignorance around what that would be, so that lack of education. And Wobbly steps in and works with the community in that way. So it was just, I'd say, looking up as if, you know, with care, with support, that there's hope for this kid's future, right? I love that sense of a new day for him and others like him. This portrait for me is so compelling. I met this mother and her child who's sleeping on her lap in the southwest of Rwanda in one of the most beautiful places. It's on a big lake called Lake Kivu. And we were out in the middle of nowhere in the woods. We took a dirt road to a dirt path to a dirt patch to get to this group of women in the middle of the village in Chiangugu, and she was learning through a Mother of Life program from one mom who was exemplary in her care for her kids and learning how to feed and care for her children. But the gaze of this mother, right? I mean, when you look at her eyes, she's a genocide survivor. She understands the dangers of life. You can see a deep bond that she has between her child and herself. And it's almost as if I was a stranger in that circle. There were a couple of others. There was this burden that she carries to protect her son and to enable her son to grow up in a healthy, safe environment in the midst of a country that's been stained by violence, violence that she's lived through. But it was an amazing morning, a really wonderful one, where I got to see some great work being done. And this boy was probably right beside her. He had just finished slopping down a bowl of porridge with some kind of like, you know, vitamin-enriched food that he'd eaten in it. And what a beautiful boy. I love the warm light under his chin. The soil's orange in Rwanda. It's not brown. It's a real orange color. So anytime the light reflects off the ground, you're going to see this incredibly warm color. And then on the top of his head there, the cool light from the sky. So even things like diarrhea kill kids in Rwanda because they just don't have the basic understanding of the impact of hygiene. And so it's a good morning. It was a good morning for him, for sure. On my way down to Chiangugu, we stopped because it was quite a long way at something called the Pete's House. It's like a little hotel, and it was dark. We didn't really get to see where we were, but we were gonna sleep for the night, get up in the morning, and complete our journey. And I was with a few other men on this particular trip, and we decided that we'd get up with the sun before the sun, and we knew we were on a tea plantation or beside one, and that we would take a hike over the ridge. So we got up that morning, and I'll tell you, it was one of the most extraordinary things I've ever seen. I remember coming up, it was the other side of the road that the plantation was on. We came up over a high ridge, and I stood, and I just looked at this extraordinary, vast landscape. You know, the Lake Kivu down in the valley with the mist just sitting inside of it, these kind of winding pathways, these hills full of tea, right? Just full of tea. And it was just so absolutely stunning, kind of mysterious, these layer upon layer of blue ridges behind the plantation. And it just kind of had this metaphor for me of a pathway. You know, sometimes we just need a pathway to be charted for us from where we are to a better place, right? That we can go, and for me, I was a part of that journey in that moment, and I love that as a metaphor for all of us. You know, sometimes we just need stones in a creek to lead us toward, you know, a more hopeful place. So that's how this painting spoke to me. I did some, for those of you who are interested in knowing, I did some creative designing to perfectly place the tree in the path. It was all there. It was a little bit rearranged in it. I liked it very much. I took a second trip with my wife Mary, who's here later in the year, but this time we were leading a group of young adults, something like a dozen young adults, and we went to the north of Rwanda this time. For those who want to go see the silverback gorillas in the mountains, people go to Rwanda. It's a safe place to do that, and this area, Ruwengeri it's called, is surrounded by 7 volcanoes. It's kind of an extraordinary place. And you could go and see the girls. I didn't. I was there to do other things, but it's kind of a wonderful place. And this girl here stole my heart. She actually probably stole my wife's heart as well. I remember, Marion, you took some photographs of that, and you took the reference photo for this painting, as a matter of fact. So attribution due there. Picard, one signature still works, even though 2 people contributed to the painting. But, you know, some people just have it, and Evelyn just had it. I mean, we were on a work site, we were building a clay brick hut for an elderly man in the community, and really that was just a way that we could be useful. I don't know how much use we were to them. They were really teaching us more than we were helping them on this trip in terms of the Rwandans and the community. But Evelyn was always around the work site, and she was leading a procession at all times, and everyone always knew who was in charge, and she's just like a natural born leader. And then she, at some point, just very short cropped hair, but at some point she popped this wreath around her head. It's a banana leaf wreath, and they use them to balance large vessels on their heads. You see Rwandan men and women walking around with all this stuff on top of their heads. It's incredible balance. But this was a discarded one, and what a wonderful sort of regal transformation it created for her. I see her as like this African princess now, with this crown around her head, right? Just such a captivating image of grace. This is her again, actually. I know she looks different without the crown, and this is just a quick sketch I had done for a larger painting that I've never done. But there's Evelyn. There was, at the end of the work day, all the kids were gonna get lollipops that were in the, every kid in the village just, you know, kind of emerges on the work site. And we were gonna dole out lollipops. And who do you think organized the kids into a line efficiently? And who do you think was at the front of that line so that everybody got lollipops that day? Of course it was Evelyn. And I just wonder about her, right? Because that was 2005, so it's 2017 now. She's 12 years older. She's a woman, a young woman. I just wonder, what's she doing now? What's her life look like? She has the leadership potential of anyone I know. And I imagine with the right education, with the right condition, with the right circumstances, she could do anything, right? In a similar time frame, I met these 2 guys. They were also kind of helping out. They'd pick up one of those clay bricks because this guy was strong enough, not the little baby, his younger brother on his back. Like, he'd be our like mud brick hander. And it just, as I see the boy that's kind of just resting on his back, I'm struck by that idea of carrying one another's burdens, right? We all need help along the way. And he was tangibly doing that for us. And I just love the picture of him carrying his younger brother. I love the sense of bond they have. But just that notion that, you know, that's what brings hope when we help one another, when we see the need and we step in, right? We can do that in any number of ways. That happens in our family lives, that happens in our community life, that happens as we become frustrated with something, fill in the blank, the thing that you're currently irate about. And instead of, you know, having a connection, step in and be a part of the solution. And that this painting for me speaks to that kind of brotherly sense of humanity. You often see children that are just like, what? Like they have this presence beyond their years. I had to return to my little princess A few years later, you know, I was chipping away at this collection of work. At some point, I decided it should be called Reflections of Hope. I don't know when that was. I do a painting, put it in the gallery. Many of them sold during collections with different people in different places throughout the country. It was wonderful to borrow some of them back for the exhibition here and see them together for the first time. But I had the first one of her that was called Empty Cup was auctioned off at a private event. And it, I think, raised $8,000 for what really to go back to child survival programs, which was really cool. And I just wanted to paint her again. This time, a little larger, it was 36 by 24. And it's like she can just walk out of the painting. It hangs in Charleston at the Cecil Byrne Gallery. And Cecilia's told me, the owner of the gallery there, that oftentimes this portrait will lure in and attract people who never enter her gallery or don't enter other galleries, people of varying ethnic backgrounds. And they relay to her, and I never intended to do this, but I was so thrilled to hear it. They relay to her that they've never seen an African black child portrayed as a subject of beauty before. If you think about what the traditional subject of beauty is in the US art market, I mean, it's a white female. They're beautiful. But I found that to be so it just really struck me, because in painting the picture and them engaging it, they were affirmed in their own ethnicity. They were encouraged in a broader definition of what beauty is. So I call it beautiful. This is my last one in this collection that I'm going to show you. It's a small painting, just 9 by 12. It went into the Pastel Society of America's auction one year in a fundraising effort for them. But I call it Peering into the Future, because it's wonderful to think of how much progress Rwanda as a country has made. You know, there are still people carrying the scars, right? But for many, it's not open wounds anymore. It's scars, it's memories. But you can touch it and it doesn't hurt or bleed anymore. And I think as this boy peers into the future, you know, having access to education, having access to the economy, which has improved, though there's still disparity there. Even the forgiveness that has happened in Rwanda, where many have chosen to bury the bitterness and the resentment and to forgive one another. I've heard personal stories many, many times in the local churches in Rwanda. So I just see this boy kind of peering into the future with that hope. So we're going to shift gears now and take you to another part of the world, take you on a journey from Africa to Southeast Asia. And in just 2015, not as far back, I had the opportunity to go to Cambodia. Again, through the relationships that my church has, we were forging a new relationship with a relief and organization called Fountain of Hope, and they also work a lot with children, and it was a new thing. They work a lot to do education and awareness, as well as provide some medical supplies because of the issue of human trafficking and disease. And so I found myself there, and I'll show you a couple photographs before we look at the paintings. Cambodia has a rich and deep history. It goes all the way back to the 15th century, where the Khmer Empire was one of the largest empires in the world at the time. And the seat of that was in Angkor, in the north of Cambodia. It was believed to be the largest pre-industrial city in the world, with 390 square miles of urban area, containing these well-known temples that were rediscovered just in the 20th century. This building right here is Angkor Wat, which I'm sure you know well, and I relayed with one of my new friends that she had also visited Angkor Wat. You can go and visit now in Siem Reap in the north of Cambodia. It's the largest religious monument in the world, and it is incredible. Cambodia also suffers the scars of almost a half century of civil war. They have a very troubled past. full of genocide, Pol Pot's genocide in the 1970s, was even more gruesome than the last one we talked about. While it was longer, the Khmer Rouge ushered in their own sort of kingdom of darkness as this militant communist regime tortured, starved, executed an estimated 2 million Cambodians. They were men, they were women, they were children. And in doing so, they incited years of civil war and United Nations occupation. They believe that the death toll totaled a quarter of the population in Cambodia, which is stunning to consider. In their attempt to socially engineer a classless peasant society, the Khmer Rouge took particular aim at intellectuals. So if you were a teacher in this room, you would have been murdered. If you were a doctor, you would have been murdered. If you were a city resident, or if you were ethnic Vietnamese, if you were a civil servant, if you were a religious leader, you would all be eliminated. Anyone who remained was forced to work in labor camps. I got to have conversations with, my host driver had survived the genocide. Extraordinary to have him relay stories to me. Rebuilding in Cambodia after these decades of war, they have seen some rapid economic growth in recent years, largely by the rest of the world relief organizations. Countries like ours providing substantial development. However, these gains really are unequally shared. One of the Khmer Rouge leaders, Hun Sen, is now the leader of the country, so if you can imagine the complexity of that, there's a lot of corruption there. 40% of Cambodians still live on less than a dollar a day and are living in very rural places, and you will see rice being grown almost everywhere you look. So for rural families, life is very difficult, and they have vulnerability because of their infrastructure, their lack thereof, because of the extreme poverty, because of high infant mortality rates. They do have an issue with HIV/AIDS, huge issue with human trafficking, domestic violence, and sexual exploitation. Their education doesn't even go back beyond the 1960s. I mean, there was no school in the first half of the 20th century in Cambodia, so very recently educated. And I got to meet beautiful kids like this one. And I'll tell you the story about this little girl who saw the original piece of art in the show. I asked one of my friends who live in Cambodia to take me to the poorest place in the city of Phnom Penh. It's a fairly large, developed city. All you see everywhere you look is motorcycles going in every direction. And I said, take me to the poorest place. He took me to this slum in the city, and I was walking down these boardwalks built over like murky water with discarded debris and all kinds of stuff. And there's just kind of little one-room huts built of tin and disheveled wood. And I turned and saw this girl looking at me through the iron bars of this one-room hut. Her mother was in there with an infant. There was a younger brother kind of romping around the room naked. He popped up into the window at one point to say hi to me. And she just riveted me. She looked at me with her eyes like that, and she kind of looked at me over the sniffle of her nose. I thought, oh, I think she's a little bit ill. All the while as she looked at me, she was stringing up a hammock on these bars of the window, and I believe she was probably doing that for her brother so he could play in the hammock inside that one-room hut. And there was definitely like this sadness in her eyes, but there was still a little sparkle, you know, that sparkle that you thought, oh, if I could pull her out, the joy would come to the surface. But I'll tell you what hit me when I looked at her. She is inheriting the bondage of her community, of her family life. It's the bondage of addiction, it's the bondage of poverty, it's the bondage of disease, it's the bondage of domestic violence, it's the bondage of this whole ecosystem that surrounds her. And unless someone steps in, that's going to be her legacy. So that's why I titled it Window of Opportunity. Because, while you or I may never get to help this child, we have our opportunities, right? Think of the adoptive parents who maybe they were infertile, but they chose to adopt. And in doing so, they created a window of opportunity. Think of the teacher who decides to do that after school work. Think of, even in our own creative lives, the ways that we can choose to share our creative gifts with others, creating a window of opportunity. So for me, it spoke to that yeah, this is not a good situation there, but hope can emerge out of it when we choose to engage. When I was at, we drove from Phnom Penh down to see the work of Fountain of Hope in some far off village in the southwest of Cambodia. And I kept saying, I gotta see sunrise, I gotta see sunrise. It was the rainy season, so you didn't see any sunsets. And sunrise was very early, and nobody was particularly in love with my desire. Again, we ended up in some peace house that we were locked in, and I told my friend Nareth that in the morning I would very much like to see sunrise, and that I would very much like to be brought to some. I hadn't seen anything like this yet. I hadn't seen the countryside. I had been in the city. And, you know, he could just see my exuberance coming out. He's like, oh, it might rain, it might this, that. I said, no, it's going to be nice. We're going to go see sunrise. Sure enough, 4:45 in the morning, I'm up. I'm out. Everybody's asleep. The staff of this peace house is teenage boys, and they are asleep on mats on the floor. As I'm trying to find my way through, I get out the front door. I'm like, okay, maybe I'll find a way to the sunrise. It's a gated community because there are expensive vehicles there, which would be subject to theft or vandalism if it wasn't gated. So I find that I'm locked in. So I'm calling Nareth on his little cell phone. Nareth, you gotta get me out of here. We gotta see the sunrise. He gets me out. I kind of swept him up into the urgency of the moment, and he lost his better wisdom. Here's what happened. We get out. I can see that the sun is within 20 minutes to 30 minutes of peeking up over the horizon. I'm a little skittish. I know it's probably a couple of miles away from something pretty like this. And he starts talking in Khmer, the native tongue, to, you know, passersby. A gentleman in his probably 40s stops on his motorbike. They make an arrangement. He says, okay, you can get on the motorbike with him. He's going to take you to the rice paddy. I'm like, okay, well, I'm going to get on this bike with this stranger to drive off into the distance. And I said, great. So I take my $5,000 of camera equipment on my back. I put my hands on the shoulders of this stranger, and he starts to drive. And we're doing like 50 miles an hour on a dirt road, right, in Kampong Cham, Cambodia. I don't know where we're going. So, you know, if you have control issues, which I don't, but I remember humming a little tune on the back of that motorcycle. My threshold was stretched at the time. He turns into an area where there was rice. And things, you know, all of a sudden canals open up, and I'm just getting really excited now. And I said, stop the mic. You know, we can't talk. We just stop the mic. I get off, and my motorcycle driver now becomes my photography assistant. I'm like, take this lens, it's 98% humidity the entire time I'm in Cambodia, and it's 100 degrees the entire time, whether it's the morning, the noon, or the night. So everything's sweaty and humid, and you're trying to clean the lenses and everything else. We're trekking our way through the field, and there's a couple of guys pulling nets up out of the canal. And as we approach it, we discover that there are snakes that they've been farming out, and one gentleman is holding a snake by his tail, and the head's kind of just enough on the ground that he can play with it. And by and large, these Cambodian men are barefoot. They might have just shorts on, but most of them don't even have a shirt on if they're out in the field. And he's playing with the snake. So I'm gonna have to do this so you can see me. I looked to my photography assistant / motorcycle driver, and I went. And he went. And I was like, oh, I'm going to earn the right to paint today. So we kind of crossed by these guys. He put his foot on that snake and broke its neck and brought it home for lunch. And I got to see this, and it was a gorgeous sunrise that morning over Kempong Cham. And while I was feeling this incredible adrenal release of capturing this moment, I get a little call on my phone from Naref, who's now beside himself that he had made such a horrific choice as to put me on the back of that horse. He's comforted that I'm still alive, and now he's going to take the van to come and collect me, right? So I'm like, you know, I'm at large in the fields of Kempong Cham. But I just absolutely love this scene. I did a red under painting, and I just love the feeling of the way the light just flickers over that beautiful field.
Where is the
painting? Oh, this painting sold, and I need to do another one. I'm going to do a larger one. I've demonstrated versions of this scene, and I can't even finish them before they are gone. There's some beautiful resonance to them. This is another little moment in that same field. It looks like Ohio, but it's Cambodia, the same field. And I call it refuge. I just, you know, like beautiful kind of misty, warm sky rising up over those trees. This was the first portrait I did from my experiences in Cambodia, and I met this little girl. There was like a VBS camp at a little church in the center of Phnom Penh. It was just a lot of fun, kids all over the place. Some of the kids were orphans from down the street. Some of the kids were children of leaders that were being trained that week with Fountain Hope. They had a leader training for the week that we were involved with. And this little beautiful girl was there. She had this lovely, you see all these wonderful colorful dresses and blouses on Cambodian girls. And I call it an unfinished story because she's young, the promise of her life, the beauty, the innocence. Yet much like the country of Cambodia, her story remains to be written. And it could take a dark turn or it could be incredible. And so I think about that a lot when I think about these portraits of these kids. I thought it'd be fun to show you a sketch or two. So this is a little sketch from one of those canals. Actually, this was in the area of Siem Reap. I told my host, Moniram, who drove me around in the north, both to the temples, and I said, bring me to the country, Moniram. I want to see sunrise in the country. I was browbeating him for sunrise trips. He said, okay, we'll go at 6 a.m. We'll be there at 6 a.m. I said, why 6 a.m.? Why can't we go earlier? And he actually told me again, he was afraid that I was going to get mugged. If we went out in the dark, he was afraid I'd get mugged. So, good man. He still managed to capture some beautiful sunrise there. You see a lot of sugar palm trees. They, you know, harvest the cane sugar from the palm trees. And I love this landscape. I call it Burning Through the Fog. It's from Siem Reap. And again, just that notion that the fog of their past, of ignorance, of confusion, of the ideology that so many people espouse. I mean, the domestic violence that is prevalent in Cambodia is a direct result of a book that is taught in primary school, where women are not valued to the extent that men are. And if they act out, you just beat them. And, you know, alcoholism is an adjoining issue. It's like another appendage. So you have men who have high levels of unemployment who are now either addicted to cheap drugs and alcohol are coming home and beating their family. So, and I saw those men as I walked through the slums, and I saw that they were inebriated, and I saw that they had nothing to do. I saw the hopelessness in their eyes and all of it. I'm planning to do a painting called Broken Fathers that kind of speaks to that image that I have in my mind. But it was just such a beautiful place. This was Young Rice. It was about this high at the time. They might be just trying to get enough rice to feed their family for the year. If they have a little more, they might sell it. You would see a team of oxen and a plow that is probably the technology of 1100 AD. And then next to it, you'd see a John Deere tractor. You just see this disparity. You'd see a really beautiful home with gates around it, and then you'd see tin huts next to them. That's Cambodia, you know? Incredible disparity of income, disparity of access to just about everything. And but this gentleman was working early in the morning before the oxen say, that's it, it's too hot, and that's what they do. The water buffalo will say, that's it, it's too hot, and I'm not working. So they've got to get it done early. I call it beasts of burden, and it just amazes me that, you know, they're really deploying the exact same technological farming process that was done hundreds upon hundreds of years ago. There was another moment where I said to my friend Arep, take me to the poorest place in the city. And I had to ask him twice, because the first time was this time. He took me 30 minutes outside of the city, and I said, why are we leaving the city? And he brought me to a resettlement community. And I came to discover that everyone in that particular slum had been scooped up back in, I believe, 2007. There's a lake in the middle of Phnom Penh. It's called the Tonle Sap Lake. Well, I should say there was a lake in the middle of Phnom Penh. And developers sold off all the land. And in Cambodia, there are many who just claim squatting rights, much like you could do in Georgia here in the US. If you live there long enough, you should have a right to stay. And everyone who lived on the edge of the Tonle Sap Lake, which was a lot of people, were just scooped up and dumped out 30 minutes outside of the city with absolutely no accommodation for that inconvenience, so that that land could be sold to developers. They subsequently brought a huge tube from a river outside the city into the lake, and they pumped sand into the lake for years until it was gone. Now when it rains, and boy it rains in the wet season, there is nobody considered the need for irrigation or, you know, where water would go when it rains. That, you know, there were natural accommodations with the lake at one point. Now it's just like 2 inches of water on the streets in the middle of the city. So crazy stuff. But I met this girl. I don't think I've ever seen a more beautiful child in my life, honestly. And she's living, she's sitting on this little step in this boat next to this ramshackle hut, again over like discarded debris, garbage, there's filthy water, it's kind of murky underneath, so they have these stilts and kind of landings they can be on. And, you know, for me, this one is like a painted prayer. It's my prayer for her protection amid the many, many dangers that she's surrounded by. She's very beautiful, and her beauty is not an advantage in some conditions. This is another sketch that I'd sent to China to be in the permanent collection of the Ming Gallery, but it got lost / confiscated. So something else is there now, but we went while in Siem Reap to see traditional Apsara dancers dance in the traditional method, and it was just captivating and so beautiful. This young lady was there. You know, you see how beautiful she is, and then you realize the dark side. This is another painting that's in the show here. It's estimated that 1/4 of Cambodia's women are victims of domestic violence. The most common and serious crime in Cambodia is rape. Cambodia is a source, transit, and destination country for human trafficking, as I suspect you probably know. But despite human trafficking being a crime in Cambodia, the country has a significant child sex tourism problem. And poor children are particularly vulnerable, hence my previous painting. So the ECPAT, Cambodia, reports that as many as 1/3 of the trafficking victims in prostitution are children. I know you don't want to hear that, but you know, I just think often, what difference are those kids to my kids as far as their intrinsic value, right? These beautiful girls are wearing their school clothes. We were out there in Kampong Cham again, and I couldn't call this painting Onlookers. Look at the strength in her. She's sitting on, they're both sitting on bicycles. And they, you know, ridden their bicycles up to watch from the outer periphery this whole program that Fountain of Hope is doing with kids, and the kids, the little kids are having a blast. They did puppet shows and all kinds of creative educational means to educate these kids on the diseases like malaria and dengue fever that were all around them. They were mosquito-borne diseases, and then the issues of drinking unclean water. And as those kids were learning, these girls were watching. A little bit after that, there were groups set up with Cambodian leaders that were trained by Fountain of Hope, teaching preteen to early teen girls how to avoid HIV/AIDS, how to avoid being taken advantage of, how to value themselves. It was very, very powerful. I stood and observed that. I even have some video of it. It was very, very touching. And this happens bi-weekly in this particular agency's work. They go to different provinces in these far-flung places and do these bi-weekly puppet shows and programs to help them understand how to prevent these really fatal diseases as well as social ills. And I just think, you know, they look like wary onlookers. Should I trust you? You know? And it just strikes me, just the power and the poise of that gaze. This painting's in the show. Let's end on we're almost done. I'd love just in the last few minutes for you to ask questions if you have any, but I call this painting Joyride. It's the most recent in the series. I finished it the night before the exhibit. You know, I really wanted it on the wall, and it's just a declaration of joy. It's a declaration of the innocence of childhood. You can't put a price tag on joy. She's one of the orphan kids that lives down the street from the church where they did the theater training and EBS and all that fun stuff. And, you know, you can't trade that joy like a commodity, can you? And it just, for me, it speaks of the beauty, the wonder of children, and the hope that rests on the life of every child that we see. And when I look at the faces of kids, and certainly you see them in the exhibit, it never gets old to see that innocence, that hope, that beauty. And, you know, my prayer is that she'd be able to ride into the future with new hope, with new opportunity, with new dignity as a young woman. So I thought it'd be fun just to have a little, this is a little path, another one of these spots up in Siem Reap where the sugar palms rise up in the midst of sun, the sunrise and the water and the rice paddies. Just, it doesn't get any more beautiful. It really doesn't. In these two trip contexts, well, three, we were kind of being carted by the development agency, so I wasn't able to do any more than a little bit of sketching and photography and video work, so I didn't do on-site work. I'm hoping that I can create a trip where I can just be a painter the whole time and have more opportunity to just do that.
That's beautiful.
But, yeah, I mean, typically I had about 10 days in country in Cambodia. and a little bit more with the Rwanda experiences.
Does Rwanda relate anything to the apartheid in Africa?
Do they relate?
Yeah, apartheid was in the early 1990s.
I don't believe there was any engagement with apartheid. You know,
if I'm not mistaken, Belgium. My history of apartheid was more of a South Africa, more of a Dutch settlement area. Rwanda was maybe French.
It was French and then some Belgian. Like, so the identity cards came in for Hutu and Tutsi, and there's a very minority of almost a maybe 1% of a forest-dwelling aboriginal tribe called the Twa. So it was advantageous to be Tutsi, and they were doing identity cards. So that created even more tension, and there were outbursts and violence that occurred throughout the 20th century.
I met somebody who was a survivor of apartheid.
Wow.
And he turned into an opera singer.
Wow, that's beautiful, isn't it? In the back?
Obviously, there's no health care, but would you, with these groups, were there medical people helping?
Yeah, well, that's, you know, absolutely. And there are some wonderful, very focused relief organizations. One of them that I can think of is, what is it called? Doctors Without Borders or something
Yeah.
like that.
Yeah.
And, you know, I'll tell you, you know what I was impressed with walking through Cambodia? If there was a school in a slum, it was run by a Catholic church. I was amazed by that. I thought, good on you, you know, well done, well done. And then you would see, many, many organizations. Cambodia is one of these places that has droves of development organizations. However, the government leadership is systematically corrupt. Hun Sen was a Khmer Rouge military leader who was about to be shot by his very paranoid boss, Mopat, when he was let go and he ran over the Vietnamese border. And because he is so effective at survival, he rose up in the Vietnamese military to be a top-ranking leader in the opposing military force. You can imagine what he was able to do. They hate each other. When everything settled, Hun Sen was put as a puppet leader initially over Cambodia, and through his very effective survival techniques has managed to reinvent himself to this day. And as long as foreign nations throw millions of dollars at him, he'll smile at the rest of the world. It's complicated.
What kind of action do you envision?
Well, listen, I'm an artist, so I'm just trying to find a way to, I have a vision to create in the Cambodia collection, in the current exhibition, 30 paintings, some of them much larger paintings that can tell a much broader, richer story. I've mapped it out. it exists in my mind completely and in PowerPoint. But I'm going to need to find a way to fund the studio hours because it's just going to be a lot of time. I'm also looking forward to finding ways to invite other people to tell their stories of how they're engaging with hope, right? So mine's one. There's so many others. Yeah?
I lived in Beijing for 3 years, and we traveled through Southeast Asia, and we went to Cambodia, and we were given the name of a woman who was a CNN, nominated CNN hero 1 year back in maybe 2010, 2011. And she was our contact through to be our guide. And she had been a school teacher, and she lost 13 people in her family to Khmer Rouge. Her father was a school teacher. He was killed. She eventually taught school. And then to make more money for the rest of the family, she would give tours through the temples. And the children all come up and want to sell you postcards and books and this and that, and that's their only way of making any money for them. So she'd say, why aren't you in school? You know, we can't afford the then buy uniforms and books and things like that. So she started with one child. And from her extra money of being a tour guide, on top of being a teacher. And she, when we met, she had three schools. And she took us through Tunnel South Lake, outside of CMU, and she took us to the villages. And it's unbelievable because it's part of the Mekong Delta. So these people, when we were there, they were fishermen, and their houses weren't built. And she said, how do you think they make their living in the off season when the lake goes completely down to nothing? And they literally had alternate houses that they moved, and they became farmers. And they farmed what was the lake bottom. I mean, I've got to put you in touch with her. She has an association. Someone from the States went and set it up. Moved to Texas, moved from Texas to there. Anyway, there are people doing wonderful things there in their Cambodia.
Yeah.
So, I got to talk to
you. Any other questions? Yeah.
How deep are your portraits before you start to use the pastels? Like, do you really get into the detail with your sketches, or are you just trying to keep them light in between, moderate?
Before I apply the pigment? Yeah, they're very loose. I tend to frame it out. I kind of mass it in, and I'd be fun to put one up in process. But yeah, unless it's a very complicated composition, I'll do a little more fine drawing. But I prefer to kind of start from the general and work toward the specific.